महेश पाटिल जॉइन्स अस, को सीआईओ आदित्य बिरला सन लाइफ म्यूचुअल फंड. महेश, द रिंग ऑफ कमीशन कमिंग डाउन और फीस कमिंग डाउन इज नॉट अ गुड साइन, बट द आर्ग्यूमेंट इज दैट द एएमसीज हैव बिकम have reached a size in last 4 or 5 years. So it's high time the benefits of size of economy and size of scale should be passed on.
Yeah, sure. I think this was coming actually. There were indications by SEBI that expense ratios need to come down because we've seen that over a period of time funds also, because of as the outperform alpha generation in the fund has come down, I think there was need to really look at the expense ratio. And yeah, it's beneficial for the investors because finally it gains in terms of the returns. I think for the mutual fund industry, I think part of the gains will have to be borne by the distributors, and there will be some impact which will be there. But I think the industry is looking to grow. We've seen a good growth in the last 3 years, and it's continued likely to grow for the next 5 to 10 years. So I think scale should be able to take care of the kind of immediate impact which will be there on margins. So I think it should be able to, over a longer term, I don't think it should really make such a big difference, because scale and what it looks like should be able to make up for the loss in profits, which would impact for the next 1 year or so.
But you're saying that the costs will be passed on to distributors, right?
Yeah, I think partly. I mean, it has to be borne by the manufacturer as well as distributor, but I think bulk of the pass on will be to the distributors.
Okay, let's talk about big picture, and the big picture is that rupee is weak, oil is strong. As of now, the crude price has been passed on here to the consumers, and which indirectly will have an impact on spending patterns, disposable income. Do you think somewhere markets, they need to realize that the regime has changed and the Indian consumer now may no longer be able to save more because interest rates are moving higher, cost of borrowing is moving higher, what you spend on petrol and other, you know, fuel related items will also go higher.
Sure.
So the question what I'm trying to ask you, Mahesh, is that why are markets so obsessed with buying consumption dominated stocks when we know that consumption will slow down?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I would arguably say that the savings has been coming down. If you look at the saving rates in the country, has been steadily coming down. But what is happening is that I think Indians, I mean, historically haven't really used leverage, okay, when they are buying any consumption item, especially consumer discretionary. And what we are seeing is a trend is that increasingly because of accessibility to finance and especially to various earlier credit was available only to a select few people, okay, who were in the high credit score bracket. But now I think because of better penetration and deepening of the financial markets, we have seen availability of credit is now available to people across the spectrum in terms of income levels. And a lot of consumers are looking at, leveraging a bit, okay, when they are looking at consumption. So that is also to some extent driving consumption growth more for consumer discretionary items. And still the overall leverage, okay, if you look at the average Indian consumer, is still very, very low. So I think given that phenomenon, while yeah, agreed that disposable income will get impacted because of rise in interest rates, but ability to leverage gives some room for consumers to go and still spend. And that's a trend I think which will continue. I think you will see the overall level. If you look at just to give an example, earlier in two-wheelers, for example, the percentage of sales which were available sold in terms of credit was around 40% or so. Now that's gone to around as high as around 65-70%. So I think that's one of the reasons what probably is driving consumption.
What is it that you're making of the market? I mean, you know, on a more shorter term, would you say that do jump in to buy this dip yet? Because looking at the market construct, you don't know where the downside could actually stall. And do you believe to begin with that the market could see lower levels from here also?
So very difficult to say. I mean, there has been, we've been talking about some of these headwinds which have been the macro headwinds for quite some time, and markets have corrected in between, but also continue to rise the wall of worry. So yeah, arguably from here on the return, near-term returns might not be that great. I mean, the risk reward doesn't look that favorable. But for long-term investors, timing the market is always difficult, right? Mm. And looking at the fundamentals, while macro headwinds are there, I think rupee has depreciated, but bulk of the hit has been taken, right? As rupee depreciates, even for foreign investors who are looking to invest, I mean, In dollar terms, already it is cheaper by around 6 to 7% or so. And the micro is still looking good. It's not that it's not impacted so much. In fact, the rupee depreciation, if at all, improves the overall earnings. So for the Nifty companies, because of the rupee depreciation, there would be actually be a marginal upgrade to earnings, because it is a lot of companies sectors benefit because of that. So there is no real impact on the earnings per se, as it at least at this point in time, unless there is a big slowdown. Because if there is severe tightening, interest rates go up too much, and that impacts demand, we are not still in that zone at this point in time. So I would say that yeah, there could be some minor correction in the market. Don't expect a large correction. And clearly, I think one should be buying in those dips, because the medium long term outlook still looks fairly good, because I think the recovery, what we have seen in the broad economy, earnings growth trajectory, which is improving, should be able to deliver decent returns from a medium to long term perspective, even from these levels.
So across your equity schemes, amongst the disclosed names, is there any fresh buys that you've made in this current decline?
So again, it will be more stock specific, I would say, because sectorally also, I think in some kind of a bias towards, as a rupee depreciation has kind of improved the outlook for a few sectors, be it in the IT sector or in the pharma sector or even the metal space, for example, because the sector has corrected over there, but we haven't seen any meaningful impact on commodity prices and rupee depreciation to really help improve the profitability over there.
But so isn't metals risky right now, given that there are trade war tensions and you don't know how that situation will escalate?
It looks risky, because I mean, intuitively you would feel that because of trade wars, okay, you should see impact on demand, global demand, which should affect the commodity prices. But I think what is happening is that there is two counter balancing forces. One is the on the supply side, we've seen production cuts continue in China, and so that has taken away a lot of capacity. And while China, which is the largest consumer, has seen some kind of a slowdown, and there are fears that because of trade wars you could see a slowdown over there, then the government is actually reacting back and they're stepping up their investments in infrastructure again. So I think with this kind of balance, I think the overall outlook on the metal space looks fairly good, and domestic companies are also benefiting because of the cash flow generation has been very, very strong, the free cash flow generation. So you would see a significant deleveraging happening there in the next few years.
Mahesh, from now to elections, we will see volatility. All kind of permutation combinations will be talked about. Who's going to be the next administrator? That is something which will keep everyone curious. How do you propose one should approach this volatility?
So I think again, no one knows exactly what the result.
But everyone will have an opinion.
People will be speculating on that, and that will have an impact on the market. And we see that every time, right? Every time during the elections. I mean, 3 months before the elections and 3 months after the elections, there is volatility depending on how people speculating about the outcome, and actually when the outcome comes through, people reacting to that. But historically, what we've seen is in the last whatever 4 or 5 elections, what we've seen, it doesn't really matter. Okay, for an investor who is having a say 2 to 3 year view, I mean, these kind of events come and go by. If at all because of some concerns you see a kind of correction in the market, it always historically at least it's been a good buying opportunity is what we have seen. I mean, stick to your fundamentals, stick to your stocks, because market increasingly would deliver and reward earnings growth is what we are seeing. And we're seeing that happen also now, I mean, in the market after the quarterly numbers. And that trend will continue.
You bought a lot of wholesale NBFCs, or I would say NBFCs, in the past. One stock which has done very well for you, and remember this reading in the bulk deal, that's how I remember, is Cholamandalam.
Right.
Now, interest rates are likely to move higher. NBFCs basically borrow wholesale, they lend retail. How does the business environment, the market outlook, and also the P multiple will change when interest rates are likely to move higher?
Yes, you are right. I mean, there would be some pressure on margins because as wholesale, I think interest costs go up in the system. Again, you look at the NBFCs, how the asset liability mismatch, okay, where there is the maximum, okay, the impact will be higher. In a lot of these NBFCs, there is an ability to really pass it on down to the end consumer and reprice on the asset side. So the impact would not be that much. Obviously, because of near-term liquidity squeeze, ability to, for example, raise money could get impact, and that could impact some amount of growth in the near term. But I think liquidity squeeze would be temporary, right? I mean, we don't see that continuing for a long period of time. And again, as I mentioned earlier, also within the NBFCs, one need to start differentiating over there within the NBFCs, okay, which have got a very strong pricing power, and not seeing much competition coming in for the banks, because banks would be in a favorable position over there, with especially banks with high CASA ratio and strong liability franchise. So I think some more differentiation NBFC is now warranted, and sticking to the strong NBFCs, okay, where there is not much of a asset liability mismatch, good pricing power on the assets, and I think they should continue to do well. I mean, there would be some kind of a derating which is possible, and we've seen that already happen in the last few months.
Okay, so Mahesh, you've increased your overweight when it comes to IT and pharma. You're turning now bullish on metals as well, selectively. You've just given us your view on NBFCs. It's a status quo position there. Where are you going underweight? Where do you think it's now time to profit take?
So I think clearly the rate sensitives, okay, would see some kind of impact, okay, because expectation of interest rates are going up over there. So that's one area where some amount of profit taking, okay, could happen.
So you mean purely banks and autos?
Yeah, it could be, yes, yeah. Okay. Yeah, not necessarily autos, again, one has to look at within the sector, okay, whether it's two-wheelers, four-wheelers, but clearly these two sectors could see some kind of a moderation in terms of expectations for growth over there.
Okay, Mahesh, fantastic to have you, and hope to see much more of you going forward. Well, we've been talking about PSU banks and the consolidation, and what we've done is that we've looked at a list of banks which need either capital or